Good evening. Welcome to the July 27th Board of Zoning Appeals. If you please rise for the Pledge of Allegiance.
I pledge allegiance to the flag of the United States of America, to the republic for which it stands, one nation, under God, indivisible, with liberty and justice for all.
Give a brief explanation of what the procedures will be for this evening. We'll have the zoning staff present a brief summary of the report for the appeal. The applicant will be given the opportunity to speak to present his or her evidence. Anyone else in favor or opposition of the appeal will be given an opportunity to speak. The public portion of the input will then be closed, and board members may ask questions to the applicant, staff members, or others who have testified. After a discussion, a motion will be made by the board member to either approve or deny the appeal. In the case of it is approved, we will there will be a straw vote. It'll be, you'll just see the zoning office for that certificate. If you need any details as far as hardships and Duncan factors, we do have a paper in the back that explains that, and that's what I'm reading from up here. This is important to keep decorum and respect. Sometimes people can get heated and frustrated. We ask that you keep your tempers at bay, and that you show respect to us and to each other. With that, do a roll call vote, please.
Mr. Bartolt?
Here.
Mr. Martin?
Here.
Mr. Price?
Here.
Mr. Reininger?
Here.
Mr. Roberto?
Present.
All right, we've got quite a few people that have signed in to speak this evening. If you would, please rise and raise your right hand, and we'll swear you in. Do you affirm you will tell the whole truth and nothing but the truth before the Board of Zoning Appeals? Say, I do. Thank you. You may be seated. Our first case this evening would be for BZA 2016-09. It's a variance request for Section 8.3.1 pertaining to the minimum frontage yard setback. Also, Section 15.8.3, subsection G, number 1 and number 3, pertaining to the maximum allowable area for business wall signs, as well as Section 14.5.2, subsection A, number 1, pertaining to the rear yard buffer requirements between a B2 general business zone and a R4 residential zone. The locations are as follows: 3680, 3688, 3696, 3704, 3712, and 3720, all on Springdale Road. The applicant owner is Tim Bichelle, Bichelle Investments Limited Partnership. Staff, do you have a presentation?
Yes, we do.
Thank you.
This particular piece of property is located on Springdale Road opposite Northgate Mall, towards the Macy's side. It is east of Flat Top. Previously, there were six single-family homes on the site. All six of those homes have been cleared, and a new Goodyear Tire Center has been constructed on the property. We have a site plan that was submitted, and you reviewed a portion of this back in May for a Goodyear Tire Store, which is almost completed. There's still a few site work things that need to be done. Since that time, we've received an additional site plan for a Freddy's Steak Burger that would be directly adjacent to Goodyear. And we have a preliminary plan for an additional, possibly fast food restaurant on this property. This is a little bit of an unusual request. Under Colerain zoning, typically when you have multiple buildings being constructed as sort of a homogeneous unit, meaning you have cross access, cross utilities and such, they're done as what we call double letter zoning or planned developments. Those are reviewed by our zoning commission, and they really look at variances and so forth with respect to larger scale, multiple building type developments. In this particular case, the property zones single letter or B2 general business. So these come in as straight variance requests. There are three independent requests as part of this application. The first is for a buffer yard, which you saw back in May. The buffer yard was pertaining at that time only to the Goodyear site. What they're asking for now is for the properties to the east of that with similar consideration. The zoning code requires a minimum of a 40-foot wide strip with a privacy fence and landscaping. That was originally approved for the Goodyear site prior to the conceptual development further to the east. With this further development, what the applicant would like to do is have a cross-access easement across the backs of all of these properties to be able to get traffic to feed out to Flat Top Drive and have access to the traffic light at Springdale Road. This actually shows on the map the locations of the traffic lights. And you can see that there's one at Colerain in Springdale. The next one will be at the entrance to Northgate Mall. There's a First Financial Bank that is just under construction. And shortly at that traffic light, there'll be a new Kroger Marketplace. And then the other one being at Flat Top Drive. As was discussed at the last meeting, there was some note that there is no specification in our buffering requirements as to where the privacy fence is placed. In this particular proposal, they're proposing to put it adjacent to the parking rather than on the property line. And that seemed to be a preference of the Board of Zoning Appeals at that meeting. Like I say, the zoning code does not mandate it be on one side or the other, so we really leave that up to the applicant. We did have an adjacent property owner come to us in the interim and state his preference would be that the fence be on his property line because he has a fence and they didn't necessarily want to have a fence 30 feet of landscaping and another fence. They'd prefer to have the barrier on the property line. But I think it's all a matter of preference. But this is the proposal. The amount of landscaping would stay the same. It would simply become slightly more compact with this proposal. And this is a little more close-up view. The second request is pertaining to the front yard setback for the Freddy Burger. With the 40, if they do the 30-foot easement in the back plus the cross access, their standard building doesn't quite fit the footprint of the site. It would extend into the front yard by 3'11", and that's out of a required 50-foot setback. It's a fairly straightforward request. The setback is measured to the front wall of the building. I noted in the staff report there's a 10-foot awning which hangs out over the front that's supported by posts. Open porches are allowed to extend 10 feet into the front yard by right in zoning. If you grant that request for the 3'11" variance, that awning would go an additional 3'11" towards Springdale Road. It's for outdoor dining purposes. And this is a little more close-up view of where that would be. The third request is regarding signs. They're proposing a sign on the Springdale Road frontage of the building. That particular sign is, I had the number, I will find the number. It's 47.5 square feet is the allowance, and that's based on the building being 47.5 square feet wide. They are proposing 112 square feet of signage. So that would be for additional size of sign. We did note that the ice cream cone is part of their logo. It's copyrighted as part of their advertising, and that is considered signage as well. Also, as note, we do have a height restriction for individual letters of a sign, but we don't have a height restriction on logos. This logo is about 7 feet tall, So it's substantially larger than we would normally allow a letter to be in a sign. The first rendition that came in for this restaurant also had signs on the sides, both sides of the building. In conversations with the developers, they understood that they were already asking for more than double their amount of allowable signage on the front. We strongly discourage them from going for additional signage on the sides of the building. So that's been deleted, even though that was sent out with the packet. So we're only dealing with the signs on the front of the building at this point. This is some of the construction. These were taken, I think, last Thursday or Friday as they were installing landscaping. We will note that there was a tremendous pressure on Goodyear to get moved in because they needed to vacate their old site for the construction of the Kroger Marketplace. Because this question of access in the rear was still up in the air, they did go ahead and build this, assuming they would get a variance for the 30-foot buffer yard. This is somewhat at their own risk, realizing that if this is not approved, they would have to modify that parking in the back of the building to meet zoning. They have not requested their final inspection for zoning purposes on this. But as you can see, the landscaping is quite dense. It includes quite a few evergreen trees. There's still trees in the background you can see waiting to be planted. So it's a pretty generous allowance. And this shows the remainder of the lot pretty much in the center is where the Freddy Steak Burgers would be. And you can see the houses in the background that would be screened with the fence and the vegetation. Another close-up of that. Staff findings, the buffer yard reduction is substantial. It's about a 25% reduction. The front yard variance is about a 7% reduction, and the sign area is about a 236% increase over the allowable area. The rear yard variance would help reduce traffic conflicts on Springdale Road for the Goodyear Tire and all of these sites. You did have a copy of the traffic study that was conducted for this property, noting that some of these entrances on Springdale Road will be right in and right out only. And that does restrict, and if people pull into a single site and they want to have the ability to go to the site next door, they would basically have to go back out on Springdale Road, either find a place to turn around and get back in, or you know, it'd just be awkward getting from site to site without cross access. So staff sees that as a very desirable quality to have in this development. The property would be likely to have a reasonable return without the variance, meaning that they are perfectly developable as individual lots. We just see a advantage of treating them as more unified development. Granting of the variance would probably not have a negative impact on neighboring properties. If additional mitigations or measures are implemented to protect the adjoining residential properties, approval of the variance has no effect on governmental services. There's no unusual topographic or site configuration issues related to this property. And taking into consideration the benefit to the applicant, weighed against the detriment to the public health, safety, and welfare, and the broader community, staff is finding that substantial justice would be done by granting the variances to allow better access to the property, allow for the front yard setback, its somewhat minor request, and for the sign variance for the front of the building, it would help for their name recognition and so forth. Are there any questions regarding this proposal?
There was a reference in a letter we received talking about a pole sign.
Yes.
That's It's not mentioned in any of these variances, so is that...
They are not requesting a variance for the pole sign. I think what they were alluding to is that if they did not get the variance for the wall sign, they may come back for a variance for a pole sign. In keeping with past cases, we have granted other people more consideration for wall signs than for pole signs, and have been very adamant on keeping the height and size restrictions for pole signs.
Okay, thank you. Any other questions for staff? All right, is the applicant present? And you came in late, so I need to swear you in. So come before the podium. Come on in. You swear to tell the whole truth and nothing but the truth before the Board of Zoning Appeals?
I do.
Name and location, please.
Hey, good evening. Craig Abercrombie with Abercrombie & Associates. I'm at 3377 Compton Road. We were here a few months ago, and after the hearing, we kind of set me and Mr. Beischel and his folks sat down with Freddy's and tried to find a building that wasn't as deep, so we didn't have to ask for another variance. But speaking to them, with the depth of these lots, they just could not find a way to make a building 10 foot shallower. So we kind of regrouped, sat down with our landscape consultant, realized that the original landscape plan wasn't very good. As we talked about in the last meeting, the fence was on the rear property line where it pretty much blocked the proposed landscaping. So we had him put together a much better rear buffer plan, and really just are asking for a reconsideration from the last meeting of the variances. Trying to show you a bigger picture of the development, which we did not do last time, and along with the sign variance that Freddy's had requested upon working with staff. So I'd kind of like Tim Beischel to kind of give a little background on the property, and I'll step back here.
Okay. Someone else speaking in favor then?
Yes.
Name and address, please.
Yeah, Tim Beischel. We're the owners of the development properties on Springdale Road.
Okay.
We had previously owned the property where the existing Goodyear store, McDonald's, Sipsy Klein, Fifth Third existed. That property was bought in the late 60s, and there originally was an old a nightclub there that was sort of a dearth to Colerain Township, which we removed. And what we provided there since the late 60s has been successful development of long-term tenants that were still there until recently when the McDonald's moved across to Northgate Mall. What we're trying to do here is make the development a visually pleasing space. We've worked on, as Craig said, with the landscape person and tried to make amends based on what your comments were from last time. We also felt that with the 25-foot buffer that was already agreed to for the Cincinnati's property, we weren't going to try to go all the way to a 25-foot buffer, but only to a 30-foot buffer, realizing that there was still 5 feet, but that's where we decided then to put the new privacy fence. Hamilton County, as mentioned before, approved the in-and-out drawings. We did a traffic study, and those correspond with what Hamilton County did approve. So, all right.
Thank you.
Thank you.
Anyone else to speak in favor of this appeal? See none. Anyone to speak in opposition to this appeal? If you would just one at a time come to the podium. Bernie, you can come first if you like. Start them off. There's several, so. Okay. If you can just state your name and address.
My name's Wilford Lynn. I'm right directly behind a Goodyear store, 3721 Susanna, and that's 3720, the Goodyear store. And the 30-foot buffer, I thought it was going to be 40. I'm concerned about the traffic going through and back of that, like in the evening and everything. I have no problem with the privacy fence being at the curb zone, because the way it is now, it's up like this, so the cars parked there all night. We don't really see them now because all the trees have limbs on them, and when the limbs fall in the wintertime, we'll see those, you know, we'll see those cars parked in the back. So if the privacy fence was against the curb, it'd be okay. But I'm concerned also about the buffer zone, you know, the 40-foot, because the drive-through would be a lot of traffic going through to the restaurant. So that's all I have.
Thank you. Anyone else speaking in opposition?
Hi, my name is Jeanette Gilder. I live at 3711 Susanna. Can you go back, sir, to one of your pictures of the property, the wide-angle view of the property? The construction.
That one?
Yeah, they've taken this picture from across the street, and it's if you would take it from the property, you can see that they've raised the elevation of all the property. I have a deck in my backyard that I cannot even sit at anymore because of all the construction and the dirt and everything. And I have a pool, and, you know, when they start building, it'll be even worse. But the 40-foot buffer, now they're wanting cars to drive in and out of there all night. They took away all the trees, the lights and everything. There is no privacy. A 6-foot fence is not sufficient. I bought my house 6 years ago. I intended to retire in this house. This is upsetting. I don't even want to go in my backyard. So I deny this all the way. And the Freddies.
Next. There's another lady behind you. One more.
You're just looking. That's
Gail Babst. I'm 3715 Susanna. If you're looking at that picture, you can see the roof of my back porch, the white triangle. As Jeanette was saying, that whole property up there is elevated. Even when the houses were in there before, if those people sat on their back porch, we were staring at each other eye to eye. So what you're putting in there, one, you definitely need the 40-foot buffer zone. You need maybe even a 10-foot fence elevated. Definitely not the Freddies is going in my backyard. And I used to be able to sit and listen to them order McDonald's up the street when they went through the drive-through at midnight. So putting a Freddy's in there, any kind of restaurant with a drive-through or an open 24-hour service is just very detrimental. And it's not very relaxing to sit on your back porch and listen to that kind of traffic going through there. Now you're talking an outdoor patio, I think they said, on Freddy's. So you're going to have all that noise. You talk about your traffic. We live in that street right there we live on is a cul-de-sac. Constantly people turn down Flat Top and realize they've gone the wrong way, can't get through, and they turn around on our street. You can sit there and count, 15, 20 cars a day just doing turnarounds on our street. So I don't think opening that up is going to help us with turnarounds. I really have to say I object, and I think my neighbors do. We've talked about this several times. Any fast food restaurant going in there, anything that has less than a 40-foot buffer, and anything less than, I'll say, an 8-foot privacy fence with the trees is going to be detrimental to our property. And I'm the same way with Jeanette. I was going to retire in this house. But if all that's going to happen, I'll be selling it. I had enough with the sewers going in. We went through that whole problem. Now this, I would put up with it.
Yeah, 4 years of the
Thank
year.
You.
Your turn, Bernie. State your name and name and location, please.
My name is Bernie Fiedelday, and I live in Colerain Township on East Miami River Road. How's that?
Thanks, sir.
You know, back in May of last year, the trustees rezoned this to B2. How that came about, don't know. But there's been discussion, gee, if we had a chance, we'd have done something different. But evidently that's what somebody had wanted at the time, it appears, because that's the zoning. There's not anything different than that. In other words, there's some of this in the text that said, gee, if we had the opportunity, we'd have made it a planned development where there's a little flexibility, but they would have had to do other things also. So that's just not all one way when you do a planned development where they get everything and we get nothing. It said after receiving a zoning certificate, the property owner completed a traffic impact study for Springdale Road and acquired additional property along Springdale Road for commercial development. All the property except for one was either, according to the auditor, was acquired on July the 27th and July the 31st of 2015. Except for the winner's property they keep talking about, which just was acquired according to the auditor on June the 3rd of this year. I think it's the 3rd. Maybe might be the 6th. But the bottom line is this has been going on for a year, and it act like things just happened, and all of a sudden we're just here to discuss this or various things. That's how this kind of appears, what I read anyway. It says here, this is going back now. I think this is appropriate because it goes back to the last thing we talked about here 2 months ago. It says Mr. Abercrombie stated that when he originally planned, meaning Mr. Beischel, I assume, planned the site for Goodyear, Mr. Beischel had not acquired the additional properties to the east. That is sort of correct, but it's kind of a misnomer because he had all the properties except one. So I just don't like trying to create something and it's not true. I guess a lot of this for me, I'm not gonna bore you with a lot of it because you've all read this, I guess. But it gets back to the application for this zoning variance, which was denied, I'm assuming, by the zoning administrator. Same as the one before. It was denied, so it ends up here. It was denied by the administrator. So then we get to where we're at here. This current proposal, this is the Colerain zoning appeals, their staff report. It says the applicant has recently purchased several lots to the east of the Goodyear property on Springdale Rail for commercial development. I don't know if that's true or not, but as far as this particular stretch, he had them all except for the one that we're all been talking about. So that's really not being real straight up and truthful. And I guess we get back to the Freddies and various things. Since the applicant owns all the property, there isn't an issue if the property is too small. They can make the lots wider instead of trying to maximize their profits, that's what it is, and adhere to the zoning like they're required to do. So it's not like we're hemmed in and we're boxed in and we have this, because on the far end, there's nothing there scheduled, at least not on those drawings. And the Freddies all of a sudden just cropped up, potentially that, hey, there's somebody that we can build them a building. There's nothing wrong with building, but just don't put it on. Don't put everything on the backs of the township, and the neighbors have to put up with this. That's wrong, and that's not what the zoning says either. The zoning says there is no variances unless there is a specific condition owing to a certain piece of property. Meaning that if you got a piece of land, got a hill, and you have to put your swimming pool in behind it. Well, you can't because of the property. And that's what basically BZA is all about. It's about if there's an issue with the property, you got a big hill, or you have this, you got a big ditch, you got to move this or that. We don't have that here. We do not have that here at all. It's their decision to do what they're doing. And they bring in here before you all and say, well, gee, we have to do this. Well, according to the rules, our regulations, resolution, and our laws, zoning laws, it would be illegal to do that. That's all I can tell you. It'd be illegal to do that, especially if it went to court. Mr. Kohler gave you the rundown on all the good things and bad things. One of the things that it bothers me, though, is that by taking into consideration the benefit to the applicant if the variance was granted as weighted against the potential detriment to the health, safety, and welfare of the neighborhood and broader community, staff finds that substantial justice would be done. Well, to start with, he kind of left out a few things. It says that for the purpose of interpretation of this application, the provisions of this resolution, our zoning laws, shall be held in a minimum requirements for the promotion of the public health, safety, convenience, comfort, and prosperity, or general welfare. Now, why did we leave out convenience, comfort, prosperity? Why did we leave that out when they read their staff report? Why did we do that? Because I think that's what the people are talking about, is their comfort, and definitely their prosperity and convenience. I mean, that's part of our zoning. That's part of our laws. Some of you guys got to take into consideration. I guess the thing that bothers me more than anything is it went through our administration, whoever did that, and they denied it. And they denied this one also. But yet staff comes back and approves it. We recommend it. How's that possible? How is that possible? How can they recommend it? How can they supersede their higher authority? Pretty interesting, isn't it? And it goes on to say, as for zoning appeals, to hear, decide appeals or refusal made by the zoning administrator. That would, I'm sure, be Ms. LeCount. It said the Board of Zoning Appeals shall have the power to authorize upon appeal in specific cases filed as herein provided such variances from the provisions or requirements of this resolution as will not be contrary to the public interest, but only in such cases where owing to special conditions pertaining to a specific piece of property. That's what I had said to you about the swimming pool in the backyard on the hill. Can't do it. You can't do it. You just can't do what they say they're asking you to do through the recommendations. Can't do it. I shouldn't be beating this, but you all know that already. Then it goes on to say, it shall be the duty of the zoning administrator to enforce this resolution. And that's what they did when they denied it. That's correct. They denied it. But then somebody else approved it. So I think I'd stick with the administrator. She didn't mind to start with.
I think I'm going to just leave it be because you all know what the zoning laws say. It would be a travesty to approve it. You heard from the neighbors, and I don't blame them. How's that possible? And to have a road behind, who would want a road in their backyard? Honestly, who would want that? Not one of you up there would want it, I'm sure. I wouldn't. So anyway, it's about the money. And about somebody making money and about somebody else getting short end of the stick, if you want to use that term. And that's not right because that's not what our zoning laws say. And we all have taken it over the years. We've all done this and say, hey, we'll support this. Minimum buffer required. And it's in table 14.1, shall define the minimum buffer requirements between lots based on adjacent zoning districts. We've already done that. Now they want to change that. We said 40 feet, and that's what it's supposed to be. Now somebody else wants to change that. That's not what it says here, 14.5.2. That's what the zoning says. There's been some discussion. Like, well, they're going to put a fence in and put some shrubberies in. That's one way of doing it. You can put a fence up plus the shrubberies. That's one option they have. Or they can put a bunch of shrubbery up where they don't need the fence. Now, I'm going to say this to you. At the Kroger store up here, they were to have an 8 or 10 or whatever, 8-foot, 6-foot, whatever the fence was. The safety director, Dan Malloy, was adamant about he wanted that fence 12-foot high just to keep security, those folks out of the residential neighborhood. Real adamant about that. And I think the same thing should be applied here, that there should be something that more than a 6-foot fence, if you grant it in any way, no matter what you do, that just for the security, because you know you're going to have all this all of a sudden, and we got some issues in Colerain, we all know about that, but otherwise why would the safety director say I want 12 foot at the Kroger store? This is only right down the street. So why would you only cut that in half? I mean, I know what the zoning says six, but there's things that happen. But if you would happen to, whatever you do, of course, this has something that really nothing to do with you guys. In theory, I'm sorry. And then it also goes to say the buffer shall be provided on a lot with the most intense loose use. And then, of course, that is on the Goodyear lot. Right? Buffer should be on the lot with the most intense use. Use their land, private buffer. I guess the only thing I'll say is the because of the variances and all this thing is merely about somebody's got a bad design. Somebody says, "Gee, I need this size," but it needs to be up to the developer to say, hey, your building's too big. I'm only allowed to do this. That's all it has to be said. Not that we have to bend over and do this and affect other people and neighbors and things. And as far as the road goes, that should never happen. Because sooner or later, they're going to be, and I have a question, and maybe somebody can answer it. What's the hours of the Freddy's? And what's the hours of the other supposed restaurant that might be there? Can we ask that question?
I'm sure the board will.
Excuse me?
I'm sure the board will be asking that question.
Because the bottom line is, you can't restrict hours of operation. You know that, right? Okay, you know all that. But to have a road behind my backyard, I wouldn't want it. And neither would you. So do what's best for the township and the neighbors. Thank you.
Anyone else speaking in opposition?
there'd be more people.
Jim Acton, Colerain Township. I was before the board 2 months ago. Mr. Fidley here, and he made an excellent presentation then, and I think he made an excellent one tonight. Think of the residents that live in this neighborhood. They want to go, from what I can understand and what I read, from a 24-foot wide roadway behind Goodyear, they want to expand it to 33 feet. So we're going to have a two-way going in off Yellowtop over to the two restaurants. You go in, you go out. Supposedly the parking in the back where this here fence was at was for Firestone employees. So we got this two-way roadway going in there. I'm a customer. I walk out to get my car. Boom, I'm hit because of the two-way roadway. Here comes in a delivery truck, semi, right off Yellowtop. I'm sure all of you have heard. Semis come in and out of places. The other question that I brought up to the last meeting we had with you that I was here is, this roadway going to go all the way to Kroger Marketplace? I asked you then, you know, check with Kroger Company. I'm sure they would like to see a roadway like that. That's two ways out of the Kroger Company parking lot. Right now we only got one at the stoplight. These poor people back here have to listen to these semis and cars and everything like that. Zoom, zoom, up and down through there. Somebody's going to say, well, why don't you put traffic bumps in there? That's not going to stop. You're going to hear them go across there, and the cars will bottom out probably eventually. And this here supposedly study that they have, I think you got prints of what the street looked like when the other houses were there. I think there were six or seven driveways there where people were making left and right-hand turns. Funny, a traffic study comes up and says, hey, you can't make a left-hand turn out of here anymore. You got to go all down the flat top by the traffic light. Doesn't make sense to me. Who pulled the right strings to get this changed around? Bernie also mentioned that Dan Malloy asked for a 12-foot fence at the Kroger store. I agree with him on that also. Security purposes, you need more than an 8-foot high fence. Why not a decorative fence like Kroger's going to put in? Extend it all the way down there. I'm sure the gentleman that owns this property is going to put that Kroger fence in probably. He's going to be obligated to it. He's making enough money off this. Let him do it there. As far as the frontage and the backage of this here Freddy's, I'm not against Freddy's at all. You know, I have no idea what it is. I've never seen one of them. But if the store is too big, turn it sideways. Next slide over, you might want to put a carry-out Pizza Hut there, or carry-out something. You don't need all that property. There's plenty of land there that they can do this with. What's going to happen? Is there a fourth lot there where the real estate company was and the bank? There's a lot of property there, gentlemen. A lot of property. These are questions that should be asked. My book, and I agree with Mr. Fidley, somebody didn't know what they were doing when they put this together. They didn't think ahead. They didn't think of the residents. And that's your job, my job, Mr. Fidley, and whoever else is in here. That's our job. Think of Colerain Township and our residents. Thank you.
Anyone else speaking in opposition?
I move we close the public portion of the hearing.
We have a motion. Do we have a second?
Second.
Motion second. Please do a roll call vote, please.
Mr. Martin?
Yes.
Mr. Price?
Yes.
Mr. Reininger? Mr. Bartolt?
Yes.
Mr. Roberto?
Yes. I'll be the one to accept it, but we have public portions closed, but we'll make an exception for this. I'll accept it.
Well, I didn't
know. Sure. It would be part of the public portion, so we'll take it now. Thank you. Let the record show that Mr. Fidelity has submitted the last month's meeting notes, the presentation that we've received today, as well as the zoning code booklet. I'll let the other boards review that, and we'll submit that to our staff. Did we get all our roll call, or were we up to me, weren't we?
Yeah.
Okay, we will now move to the question section. Mr. Martin, would you like to start us off, please?
Yeah, this application disturbs me for a number of reasons. First of all, I tend to like applicants to come in with clean hands. And when I heard tonight that despite the fact that you were turned down in May for the 30-foot buffer, that you went ahead and had Goodyear put the 30-foot buffer in at their own risk. It was definitely at their own risk as far as I'm concerned, because I think that was a foolish decision, and I don't know who made it, but it was a foolish decision. Secondly, I happened to turn 65 last weekend, and given the fact that I'm retired now, I actually went to Freddy's for dinner and over on Winton Road. It's a mess. Truthfully, and I didn't know that you guys were coming in here when I went over there for dinner, but it's a mess. The lot is much too small. The traffic is a ridiculous mess over at the Fridays on Winton Road, and it's exactly the layout that you've presented here tonight. The traffic flow on this lot is abominable, just like the traffic flow over on Winton Road. The lot is too small. Just like the lot over on Winton Road is too small for this restaurant. Not only is it too small for this restaurant, it's too small for a restaurant, period. Our zoning ordinance says it has to be an acre zoning. This, by your own description, is 0.97 acres. So you'd have to get a variance, in my opinion, to put this restaurant on this particular lot. And then on the next lot that you've got, the proposed restaurant is 0.87 acres. There's no way without getting an additional variance that you can put two restaurants on this lot. And you can look at page 65 of our zoning ordinance, which requires in this particular zoning district that it be 1 acre zoning. We've gone through this on Colerain Avenue, up and down Colerain Avenue for fast food restaurants. So that's problem number one. Problem number two is parking. As I read the parking requirements, you'd have to have 48 parking spaces, given the fact that you've got a 3,213 square foot building. Now you can reduce that by 10% if you do certain things, but there's no indication here whatsoever that you've done those certain things. And that's section 13.3.4b, if you want to take a look at that. So that's an additional situation that you would have to address. And all of this is, in my opinion, based upon the fact that you are trying to crowd too much onto this particular parcel. I understand that at the time, you know, Goodyear was, that there was a rush to get Goodyear in there. Well, the problem is that you made the Goodyear building too big. I mean, you should have forced somebody, and I don't know where you're getting your advice from, but somebody should have foreseen this and noticed that, indeed, these two parcels are too small. Bernie and I seem to have an affinity for arriving at the same conclusion, albeit by alternative means. But I think he was fairly prescient when he stated that at a minimum, you've got to turn this building sideways to fit it onto this lot, and then probably not put anything else there, because I don't think you're going to get a variance for a second restaurant. I would love to approve a higher fence, but 12.8 tells me I can't, unless somebody on the staff can tell me that we can override that. But 12.8 says 6 feet is the maximum height of a fence. You can go to 8 feet if it's 75% open, I think, but that's not going to give you the privacy that you're looking for. So I think I'm constrained by the zoning ordinance to 6 feet. I would love to say we can't put, I don't understand why economic development in Colerain is defined as fast food restaurants, but apparently it is. So I can't stop more fast food restaurants in Colerain, but I certainly don't want to bend over backwards and to get more in here and cram even another fast food restaurant in Colerain. So I don't think we can give you everything you want, Mr. and Mrs. Resident, in terms of the height of the fence, in terms of keeping this restaurant out of there altogether. But I think we can make sure that if this restaurant goes in there, that they, at a minimum, they abide by the 40-foot buffer in the back. At a minimum, they abide by all setbacks in the front. Because the way it's set up now in the front, if somebody turns in here,
there's room for one car here, and I saw this over at Wynton Road. Somebody turns in here and they can't park here, they've got to turn around and get out of there unless they want to get stuck in the drive-in lane. It's an awful setup. So that would also be alleviated if they complied with the appropriate setback. We can't keep you out of here. We can't keep Freddy's out of here, but we can certainly make sure that it complies with all the requirements. We haven't asked the question, again, as the gentleman here suggested that we do, in terms of the hours of operation. That is certainly something that I think we need to talk about. I mean, a lot of these places have 24-hour drive-ins, and I certainly wouldn't want to be hearing orders placed at 2 o'clock in the morning for a cheeseburger. So that's something else we're going to have to look at. So, again, I was very distressed to learn tonight, and I'll go back to that and I'll end with that, that you guys went ahead on that 30-foot buffer. That was a very serious error in judgment, and I'm not going to say that. I would have come to the same conclusion tonight but for that, but that did not help me come to any other conclusion, let's put it that way. So thank you very much.
Tim?
I actually have no questions.
Well, I guess just to get back to the less than 1 acre, is that not an issue, or how did that come about?
They have not actually, I'm still on, talked about how they propose to subdivide this property. Right now, actually, it's a whole bunch of individual single-family lots. If they choose to keep, say, well, they did consolidate two lots for the Goodyear store, and that exceeded an acre because that corner lot was slightly larger. But the other two, if they wanted to build two restaurants on a single parcel and combine the four lots, they would be able to do that under our zoning requirements.
Point of order, and council's here. I haven't met you yet, but you're council, I assume? Well, this is part of the submission that we received. So if we approve this tonight, doesn't this get...
That's what I mean. How can we even proceed with the things that they want when we see that they haven't asked for a variance for the less than an acre? That should come first, I would think.
Right.
They haven't requested to go less than an acre because they haven't proposed how they're going to
submit. No, it's on here.
What is this? It's 0.97 right here.
Yeah, it's showing the old single family lots.
No, this is right here.
Well, you're saying the one property line that's between the two restaurants is one of the original property lines?
Yes.
And if you take the two together, it adds up to 0.87 acres.
If you take all four of those lots?
Well, in other words, two of the houses is going to be a restaurant, and two of the houses would be the other restaurant, right?
Roughly, yes.
Yeah, and so they have 0.87 for two of the houses and 0.97 for the other two houses, which are the two restaurants.
Right.
But you're saying that doesn't factor in?
If they keep them all consolidated as one lot,
yeah,
then they're well over an acre.
Is this considered one big, legally, one lot now?
Not now. Now, actually, they would not even be able to get a building permit because the lot line would bisect the restaurant. They're going to have to consolidate parcels. That's like Goodyear had to consolidate parcels before they could even get a building permit.
Well, I guess that's his question. If they go to build and they consolidate these two parcels for this Freddy's, they're going to come in at under an acre.
And if they do, then we would have to issue another denial for that.
So if we say yes to this and they start building the Freddy's and they consolidate the lots, what happens?
If they consolidate all four, they would meet zoning requirements and we would approve that because it exceeds an acre.
But again, I don't mean to interrupt. I don't want to take your time. But they've already said they're going to come in for another restaurant. It says right here on the diagram. So why are we pretending that that's not going to happen?
I mean, you could have two restaurants on a single lot.
But not unless it's a 1 acre each.
No, it's just a single development site, and you can have multiple components to that site.
In one building, though, correct?
Minimum's an acre for the lot. You can put multiple buildings on that 1 acre.
Right, yeah. Okay.
On a single lot.
So you're saying they might come back and consolidate the 1, 2, 3, 4 houses where the two restaurants are going into one parcel, which is over an acre, and then they're allowed to have two buildings on that one parcel.
Correct.
Okay. Yeah, almost 2 acres. One and 3/4 acres.
Yeah. As it is, the driveway from Springdale would be cut in half by a property line.
Mm-hmm. But just like
you can deal with access.
It just seems like last May, we're being asked to approve something that is not completely set in stone yet. And I don't know why we would do that. Why wouldn't we tell them, come back to us when you've got your plan for the whole site, instead of this piecemeal stuff? And then apparently they disregarded our advice in May and they went ahead and did what they wanted to do anyway.
It wasn't advice, it was actually an edict.
Well, exactly, yeah. It wasn't, you're absolutely correct. Well, anyway, I'll be quiet. I just don't get this.
Well, I guess that's it for now.
Tom? I certainly appreciate the comments by the other board members. There's three things I think I see in this request. One is the right-of-way, one is the signage, and the other is setback from the front from Springdale Road. I think there was an error in judgment in cutting a 30-foot easement when we denied that in the first place. I think that was a bad move. Certainly colors what would come next. The signage, which we haven't really talked about, is 236% more than our zoning code permits. That's not just 2 or 3%. That to me is an egregious amount of difference. And whether we even get to that far tonight, I don't know, but that is something I would have to have a real sales pitch to convince me to bump it 236%. The third thing is the setback in the front. I appreciate the fact that an open dining area does not infringe count, but that I think was like a less than a 10-foot variance if you don't count the approved dining area. It was a small. That's the least of it. The question for our staff is, do we have the zoning part of Colerain Township define access roads? Because that's what essentially we're going to be permitting as we move forward. I don't know that that's something we can address here, but we're looking at another access road. I see that the Hamilton County engineer certainly has recommended that. Does that supersede Colerain Township zoning, or is there any guidance that Colerain Township would be providing these developers for an access road?
In terms of this, this would not be an actual access road. It is simply a parking aisle that is shared commonly. For 90-degree parking, they need to have at least 24-foot width of aisle space. And now this only benefits three businesses. By the way, Cincinnatus is in between Kroger and this particular development. Cincinnatus has no interest in having traffic through their property, neither does Kroger's, as I understand. So the traffic would be restricted to only these three potential buildings. And 24-foot width with parking is all we would need. In terms of traffic generation, a single traffic aisle in a Kroger parking lot is probably going to receive just as much traffic, if not more, than what this particular aisle would do.
So this is not defined as an access road then?
No, it would not.
I don't have so much. Well, are we going to talk about signage tonight?
We're going to talk about all three of them. And at this point, let's address the residents' concerns first, which mostly okay. Their concerns are the traffic, and then we can move on to the signage.
Okay. I have no other questions at this point.
So I'm in agreement with my fellow board members. You know, good year going forward and putting in the concrete after we said we shouldn't do that, or we weren't going to accept that, was it doesn't sit well, and does sour the pudding. I guess the questions we could ask is, can this building be turned sideways? And if it's turned sideways, then I'm thinking the square footage might come more in accordance with the signage, because it's a much longer piece of building frontage.
Mm-hmm.
So that may solve its own problem there if they turn it sideways. I count 44 parking spaces.
Yep.
Okay, so that's
I think shy by four. Yeah.
And I know that when they have a drive-through, they will allow for that as part of the parking. So you probably can accommodate for that four. So that part of it is probably not so much of an issue. You know, and then we get to the other issue as far as, are they going to subdivide the properties after they've developed this into small parcels? And you know, then it's going to come back before the board again. But it's the way it's presented to us is that's what they're going to do. You know, it's 0.87 acres on this piece, and it's 0.97 on this piece. Its intent is in there. And so that's alarming from my perspective, because now we're going the wrong direction. And then for the other restaurant, I agree with Mr. Fildy. It's basically an economic thing, and they're going to try to get as much money as they can out of this square footage. I understand as a business person, I would try to do the same thing, and I would try to present it as well, you know, before them, and hopefully it would get it through. In this particular case, I don't believe it's going to fly. Sorry, guys. So as far as the first variance, which would be for the 30-foot setback, we've addressed that. Everybody's satisfied and addressed it. Do you have any other questions for the applicants? No. All right, so let's move on to the next issue then at hand.
Well, I guess one question to staff would be, if there ever does come to the point where there's a fence, you know, between this property and the other, are we allowed to suggest that it be higher than 6 feet, or we don't have that right?
That would be a variance in itself, because the Board of Zoning Appeals really isn't a initiator of variances.
Right. So we can't recommend it.
And that's how I feel as well. I mean, we can't recommend to break our own law. So, I mean, in this particular case, they would have to come before us and say we would like 12-foot fence or whatever the variable may be, and then we have to approve or deny it. And that's how it should be approached. All right. Anything else on the access lane? All right, so we're going to move on to the next piece of that. This was the signage.
Mr. Martin, you want to start off on that? I think you did kind of address it.
I did. I just, there's, in my opinion, there's no justification for the 236%, I think, increase. I mean, we have given variances in the past. We did it for Aldi because of, there was an issue with a visibility issue from Colerain Avenue. There is no visibility issue here. This is going to be right in your face, even if they comply with the setback. So I don't see any justification whatsoever for such a large variance. If it was a, I actually, I think Mr. Roberto's suggestion is the best one, and it turned the building sideways. A lot of these issues disappear. So that's about all I have to say.
Okay.
I fully agree with Mr. Martin. If the building was turned sideways, no issues, but it's just too big for there. And I know that you're allowed to have a monument sign. Maybe that would, you know, reduce the size of that, add in a monument sign, and then you can be code.
No questions.
Nothing else.
And I've already addressed it. So then the third thing that we were talking about would be the frontage setback for the awning / patio.
Just to reiterate my concern with the traffic flow that I saw at Wilson Road, you're going to have the same problem in spades here. So again, I think you've got to comply with it 100% or flip the building on its side.
No questions on that one.
No questions.
I have no further questions, so
I move that we deny all three variance requests.
A motion, we have a second.
I second.
Motion and second. Roll call vote, please. Are there any questions or discussion? Roll call vote, please.
Mr. Martin.
Yes.
Mr. Price.
Yes.
Mr. Reininger. Mr. Bartolt.
Yes.
Mr. Roberto.
Yes.
The variance has been denied. All right, we will move on to case number BZA 2016-10 for a non-conforming use, changing the auto detailing to an auto repair. It's listed in Articles Section 11.7.3. The location is 2816 West Galbraith Road. The applicant owner is Thomas Lalaley. And does the staff have a presentation?
Yes, we do. This property is located just east of Jackie's Drive on Galbraith Road. It is zoned single-family residential, although it's been used for commercial purposes since at least the early 1950s. The particular building for this request, as far back as we know, is used as a moving and storage business. It's been approved for various other non-conforming uses, the most recent having been an auto detailing shop. Our zoning resolution does not really, we talk about auto service, which could include auto body repair, mechanic shops, detailing shops, but because it was specifically approved for detailing and they want to change it to auto repair, we felt that it needed to come back for an additional review, even though technically it falls under the same category for zoning purposes in a commercial district. Now we're in a residential district. This is located directly adjacent to another auto repair shop, and basically these would, two buildings would be used in conjunction with each other as part of the same business. That auto repair shop was approved as auto repair. It was previously a non-conforming gas station and some other uses in the past. So these buildings have been through quite a few cycles of non-conforming uses. The idea of non-conforming uses is if the buildings become vacant for more than 2 years, that they lose that non-conforming status, and that's never happened to these. But as long as they're used for a non-conforming use, they're eligible to do so indefinitely. But if they ever change that use or its intensity, it comes back to the Board of Zoning Appeals for approval. This is not a variance. It's basically a use study. The property is surrounded on the east by residential, across the street by residential, and residential to the rear. And it's been that way for quite some time. This is a map showing the property. the building is almost lot line to lot line, and the paving between the paving and the building, it's pretty much total lot coverage, as is the repair shop that's next door. This is a zoning map. It's kind of odd that across Jackie's to the to the west, there is a single lot that is zoned office, which there's some kind of an office. There's actually no signs on the building at all. The county auditor has it noted as office. We have no zoning records on that building, but it's sort of a freestanding one lot zone. That's something we typically don't encourage. But it is a, it at least showed that there was a recognition for a business on that site.
Well, they did. St. Anne's, that was St. Anne's property.
Oh, really?
We used to have fourth grade in that.
Oh, wow. It looks like it might have been a gas station at one time. Okay. That would explain it. This is a street view of the buildings. In terms of finding, the non-conforming use change is substantial, since auto repair might be construed as more intensive than auto detailing. Granting of this would not actually result in expansion of the building or of anything on the site. The property would likely yield a reasonable return without the change. It could continue as a detailing shop. The building size is not being increased. The volume of the building, the business is not expected to increase. Approval of the change would not affect the delivery of governmental services. And taking into consideration the benefit to the applicant, if the change is granted, is weighed against the potential detriment to the health, safety, and welfare of the neighborhood and broader community, staff finds a substantial justice would be done by allowing the change of use. The rationale being that the auto repair shop has been there for quite a number of years. The residents surrounding it probably have come to expect whatever can be expected of an auto repair business. Expanding to this lot next door is probably not going to have a substantial change on the neighborhood. Any questions?
Is the applicant present? Please come to the podium. You name your, state your name and address, please.
Thomas Mullally. I own the building at 2816 West Galbraith.
Thanks, sir.
And I promise I don't want a road behind it.
Okay, perfect.
Just a quick history. I know it may be running late. About 4 years ago, I've had that building for 30 years, roughly, maybe 29. We did have a detailing business, and it been great with all the neighbors. 4 years ago, I was in a wreck, disabled me, busted my hip up. So that's why it's even, we're making a change here. The neighborhood garage is right next to it. I did own the building on the corner. They had bought that. And since they bought that, they made that building just amazing. They put me to shame. And so they were interested in this building. And I can see nothing but making this building a lot nicer. I just kind of lost heart, especially the last 4 years. I've tried to keep it clean, but they, you know, would bring it up to the next level. I think it would help the property values around the place. It's with me, it's either sell or I rent. And I know how you rental, you get rental, especially if it's a detailing business. I, you know, would rather a resident like them go in there, buy the property rather than rent it, because that can go down a wrong path fast. But they're good guys. But what I wanted to say is there would be less traffic going in and out of it. We would do about 20 cars a day, so it was a constant flow of cars, and that's never been an issue. And it, you know, but there just wouldn't be that much traffic going in and out. Hopefully, there would be no negative impact. So that's why we are wanting the use of it, or the non-conforming use change. in it. I don't even know if I needed to speak, but I just kind of wanted to let you know what it is, and I appreciate you know, let me talk.
No, we appreciate you giving your information. Thank you.
Yeah.
While speaking in favor.
Thank you.
Anyone speaking in opposition?
I move we close the public portion of the hearing.
We have a motion. Do we have a second?
I'll second.
Motion and second. Roll call vote, please.
Mr. Price?
Yes.
Mr. Reininger?
Aye.
Mr. Bartholdt?
Yes.
Mr. Martin?
Yes.
Mr. Roberto?
Yes. Okay. Ms. Martin, we'll start off with you. You any questions for the applicant?
I got a question for staff first. Is this a change of a nonconforming use, or because they're combining the two lots, basically, is it an expansion of a nonconforming use?
Process and procedures are exactly the same no matter which. It's not really a
well, maybe expanding. Not, because if it's an expansion of a nonconforming use, then they've got to meet the setback requirements, and they're going to need a variance.
Oh,
for
that's
the setback
true. Yeah, there's no new construction, though, involved with this. It's simple. It's cleaner to think of it as a change of one use to another. The nonconforming use has already been approved for auto repair for the corner
right.
building.
It wasn't a rhetorical question. I honestly don't. I mean, I can make an argument either way, but I think for the record, we probably ought to be clear that this is not an expansion of a nonconforming use, because otherwise it does open up a can of worms.
It does.
Having said that, I am a little concerned, though, about going back to my coming in with clean hands argument. You know, I think this makes a lot of sense. However, I happen to live in the area. And right now, I know, you know, one of the requirements here is you have no cars for sale. Right now, the neighborhood garage does have cars for sale. Number two, the requirement is that you can't park vehicles. You would not be able to park vehicles on the parking lot and leave them there for a period of time like you do now. Now, I say that with some hesitation because the Board of Zoning Appeals does not control zoning violation enforcement. And I by no means suggest that I can have any influence on that, but I know of a numerous number of car repair facilities in town, and I pointed this out to previous people on staff, that violate this rule all the time. So if we are going to approve this tonight, number one, it would be approved with the notion you can't do what you're doing right now. You can't sell cars on this lot. Number two, you can't leave cars overnight or, you know, in some cases for a much longer period of time, just sitting there without license plates needing work. Number three, I hope that the zoning enforcement people listen to me and do this with other people, because it wouldn't be fair to put these requirements on you and not put them on others. And number four, that little sign there, the remains of a sign. I mean, if you want to come here and ask for some special treatment, which is what you're doing, then you've got to respond with in kind and kind of clean up the site. You know, some of that old sign post, for example, should be, that's a violation and that should have been addressed, but it wasn't. So I would suggest that staff make up a list of things, maybe visit the site. I'm sure that you have, but if you haven't, maybe visit the site and go over with you what would be required in order for this site to come into zoning agreement, basically. Otherwise, I mean, I think there's a lot of good arguments. I like to think that we engage in common sense up here. And I think this makes some sense to combine these two operations. But again, you're going to have to comply with these requirements, and it's going to rub you the wrong way if the other people in town don't have to. And you know who I'm talking about. Some of your neighbors down Galbraith and elsewhere leave cars out a long time. So just be aware of the requirements. So that's pretty much all I've got to say.
No questions.
Just one for staff. If we approve the conditions that you've listed,
mm-hmm.
Number two, you say no vehicles in disrepair be parked outside.
Mm-hmm.
Is there a definition of disrepair? Is that non-running, or is it
inoperable or disassembled?
Because, I mean, it doesn't mean people coming there to get their car worked on.
I have something I can put in as a recommendation.
Yeah.
I mean, that's...
I would probably say for a very brief time before it goes into the building.
I mean, a car with flat tires in disrepair.
Yeah.
Is that not allowed to be parked in front of the building?
It's considered a junk vehicle, actually, if it's not drivable. And if it has a flat tire, we'd consider it not drivable.
Well, it's a, yeah, I'm saying I might drive my vehicle to the property to get repaired.
Mm-hmm.
So to do that, I'm in disrepair. So you're saying you don't want any vehicles parked outside the property or the building that are in disrepair. And I'm just wondering, how is that physically possible? But anyway, if you want to change the verbiage...
We'll strike that. I have a recommendation that will replace that.
Okay. That's actually the exact same condition that was placed on the adjacent property at the time that that was approved.
Okay.
Questions I had more reflect Mr. Martin's comments, but for staff, signage, would there be a common sign for both buildings? Or I know there appears to be a small sign on top of each one. Would there be one large sign? The owner could address that. Do you know?
Come to the podium, please speak. Okay. Thank you. This is a recorded session, so we need to be able to hear you.
As far as the Mullally's detail on the 2816, my son vouched he wanted that after 30 years, so we're taking that one down, and there will be no new sign on that building. And so there will be less signage if we go through with this and that. So,
okay.
And I don't want to add anything, but the Mullally's, the 2816 West Galbert, they would also use that. And I don't want to speak for them, but that would also be for storage. As far as if, you know, that's one reason why they want to get a car inside overnight while they're working on it, because it's a lot bigger than their garage. So whatever that means.
Don't go away. Don't go away. Question. Where is your security lighting now on that property?
On 2816, I have a dome light out front, or actually it's two spotlights. And then down the side, there's two doors. I just have a little light on the side there. And there's one on the back. Actually, there isn't one on the back. I was relying more on their lighting because they went out, they put new lighting on their building and kind of helped me in that over the last 4 years.
Have you installed any fencing, or is any fencing required, privacy fencing?
It's basically a grandfathered non-conforming situation, so we have no means of requiring that. Now, to the extent, if you believe that this nonconformity was creating more, the change of the nonconformity was changing the nature of the business so as to need that, that could be a requirement or a condition of approval.
I'd also recommend taking that pole sign, or what used to be a pole sign, pole. Now.
Yeah, that actually is on the 2820 property.
Oh.
That's the old garage, their, you know, neighborhood garage. That's their sign. And that all I had, I mean, that's their property right there. My property ended at the end of my driveway there a little bit. The only sign I had was on the building. And as far as fencing, the fencing in the back of the building is the house. And the only fencing on that particular property is just some split rail, which a couple of pieces. That's it.
Thank you.
Thank you.
Sir, I am actually disappointed that you're going out of business. I've taken my car to your detailing. You do good work, and we appreciate the service you've done to our community.
Well, thank you very much.
Thank you. So if we make a recommendation, I would suggest we amend the recommendation so that where it says no vehicles in disrepair or be parked outside the store, outside the building. What we've done in the past is all cars parked outside will have a current license plate sticker. That makes it illegal as far as they've been licensed and it's for it to be sitting there. So they potentially could sit there for a year, but you know, if we want to put a limit as far how long that can those vehicles can sit outside, we need to address that. I agree we need to remove the sign pole. It's just as good gesture on the new owner's part if you remove that sign pole is help us clean up the neighborhood a little bit, and that's one of those abandoned signs is what it is.
And then...
There's more than one, yeah.
Yeah, so, and then the other thing is, I agree with, I'm seeing more and more repair facilities. They're also becoming sales facilities, and that's not what it's intended for. I understand it. Sometimes you get stuck with a vehicle and you're trying to get rid of it because they haven't paid their bill or whatever. I understand. But in this particular case, you're going to have to find another avenue to try to get rid of those vehicles. So that's all I have to say about it. Do we have any recommendations or...
I'll move that we approve it with those conditions that staff added. But I'd also recommend, I'd recommend staff go out and visit and look at the old signage out there, the poles that we're talking about, and maybe work with them. And hopefully they will agree to do that as part of the, and I guess we can make that a recommendation that they remove.
If they're gonna assume the other business,
right,
it really it will be the same entity. So at that point we can say,
right,
we would like to have that removed as part of the...
So I would make the motion that we approve it with the amendment that Mr. Roberto suggested and with the amendment that the old signage poles be removed as well.
All right, we have a motion. Do we have a second?
Second.
Motion, could I second. Get a clarification on that?
Sure.
Are you saying that that is the licensing requirement is in addition to number two or substitute for number two?
It would be substitute because I agree with Bob's comment is that the vehicle is being taken there because it is in disrepair. Mm-hmm. So just to make that as a statement, it's really not a valid statement, but it just needs to be a licensed vehicle.
Okay.
That, you know, it's not a junk car is what we're trying to get to. So it's not they're going to use it for parts. They're not going to use it, have something sitting out there. It has to be a licensed vehicle.
Okay. In our B2 business, or B2B3, where auto repair is a allowable use, we would not allow, say, a car with no engine in it or hood missing or all that to be sitting outside.
And if you want to include that as part of the language, is not, I would consider that a junked car or parts car.
Okay. Well, sometimes they're waiting for parts, but the idea is that you keep it parked inside until the part comes. And
sure.
So, again, is that in addition to?
Yes, we were substituting line two with that all cars parked outside would have a current license plate sticker.
Okay.
That.
Yeah.
Satisfy your. Okay.
Yeah, that'll work.
So we've had a motion and we've had a second, correct? Mm-hmm. So now we need a roll call vote.
Mr. Price?
Yes.
Mr. Reininger?
Aye.
Mr. Barthold?
Yes.
Mr. Martin?
Yes.
Mr. Roberto?
Yes. The variance has been approved. All right. Case number BZA 2016-11 would be for a variance request for a proposed accessory structure to be located in the front of the existing residential house. It's found in Article Section in our zoning book 10.2.1, subsection C. The location is at 6370 Day Road. The applicant and owner is Penelope Brooks. Does a staff have a presentation?
We do. This particular property is zoned R2, which is estate residential. It carries a 1 acre minimum lot size. This is at the corner of Day Road and East Miami River Road. It's towards the very western side of the township. The property contains a relatively new single-family house, and at the time that house was built, there was another house on the property plus a garage, which were retained as part of that site development and rehabilitated. At the time that the house was built, there was really no mention, but technically they created a nonconformity by allowing that house and garage to be in the front yard. When we have corner lots, actually both street frontages are considered front yards for zoning purposes. So we have two nonconforming structures in the front yard of this house. And this map shows the proposed location of a gazebo. It would be towards the East Miami River Road frontage, kind of towards the northern property boundary. Zoning obviously does not allow for accessory structures in any front yard setback. Oops. Oh, no. This particular, that line that just appeared is what would be the minimum front yard setback if a house were to be built right to the front yard setback line. The minimum requirement is 50 feet. This is a photo of the house looking from the corner of Day and East Miami River. It's a three-story house as it faces the road, and it's built in architectural style that very much resembles a converted barn. And it sort of fits in with the character of the neighborhood quite well. These are the two structures that were retained and rehabbed as accessory units. And you can see the house in the background with the red roof. You can kind of see to the right of the smaller house how the hillside goes up in the backyard. They have a pretty steep hill. And I think I have another illustration of that. And this is looking from across East Miami River Road. The, if I can get my arrow going, the proposed location would be just about 15 feet behind this this rail fence, board fence. The style of the proposed building is open on the sides. It would have a roof to pretty much match the house. There's also a sawmill, old sawmill across the street that has a standing seam metal roof. This front yard, we did note in the floodplain maps, is in the 100-year floodplain for the Great Miami River. I did talk to the building department and show them the plans, and they have no concerns with it being located there because it's totally open and because it's not habitable. You wouldn't store anything in it, nobody living in it. If the flood did come, the flood would go right through the building rather than become an encumbrance. This is an end view of the proposed building. This is a shot of the backyard, which is that sort of eligible area to build an accessory structure. They've done some very extensive landscaping and terracing of the backyard. And findings. And this one's a really tough one. This property is, I would say personally, quite a gem in that part of the township. It really captures that sort of rural, farm agrarian kind of look to it. They've done a fantastic job with the fencing, with the landscaping, with the terracing of the yard. But we do have a requirement that says we would not have accessory buildings in the front yard. Obviously, if we were in a housing subdivision, which is typical of most Colerain Township developments, this would be, I think, a real no-brainer that we would say, do not put an accessory building, even a picnic shelter, in your front yard. That's just not the norm. The idea of having a front yard is to have a sort of unobstructed open space within your front yard. The setback request is substantial since the zoning resolution prohibits accessory structures in the front yard of principal buildings. The granting of the variance would grant consideration that's not available to other property owners in the neighborhood. The property in question would likely yield a reasonable return without the variance. Granting of the variance would probably not have a negative impact on the neighborhood, but would create a precedence to allow for accessory buildings and front yards if requested by neighboring properties. Approval of the setback variances would not affect the delivery of governmental services. While there are some topographic and underground challenges, and I probably should have mentioned theirs, in the front yard has a geothermal system underground, which takes up a fairly good chunk of the front yard, and a septic system as well. There's no unusual topographic or site conditions related to this property that would prevent a reasonable application of the setback regulations. And lastly, by taking into consideration the benefit to the applicant, if the variance is granted, is weighed against the potential detriment to the health, safety, and welfare of the neighborhood and broader community, staff finds that substantial justice would be done by granting the variance for a front yard garage building. I think I should have said, oh, would not be done. I missed not, keyword. The difficulty that we find is basically precedence and also the extreme of, if you compare the allowable area where if they put the gazebo within that area, we wouldn't even be having a meeting, versus where the proposed location is. We wouldn't even allow a principal structure to be that close to the road. Any questions?
Questions? Okay, thank you. Is the applicant present? Can you please come to the podium? What's your name and address, please?
Penelope Brooks, Penny Brooks, 6370 Day Road.
Thank you.
He said it all. It's just a... it's going to kind of look like another old farm structure, only it's going to be a new folly, for lack of a better term. I'm going to landscape around it and sit in it. And the house was built, actually Mr. Rash is across the street and up there, and it was the same design as his bank barn. It's to look like an old Ohio bank barn, and it's just going to look like another accessory old farm building. So I really don't have much else to say.
All right. Well, thank you.
Okay.
Is there anyone else to speak in favor of this appeal?
I didn't sign in, but I would.
Well, then if you would please give us your name. Have you been sworn in?
No, I haven't.
Okay. Well, we will do both. Can you give me your name, come to your podium, give me your name, and we'll swear you in. Name and address.
Darlene Reynolds, 6318 Day Road.
Give me a second.
Okay.
What was the address again?
6318 Day Road.
Okay, can you raise your right hand, please? Do you swear to tell the whole truth and nothing but the truth before the Board of Zoning Appeals?
I do.
That's fine.
Just that, if you could go back to that one slide where it shows the allowable proper, the allowable area. My house is on top of that big hill behind Penny's house, and no objection to her putting it anywhere. I mean, I know you guys have rules and regulations and things, but it would only add to, really, the gazebo that she would want to do would only add to making the property look even better than what it does. It's gorgeous. It's already beautiful. And my grandpa actually owned that property in the sawmill, and she has done so much with it. And it would just add to the community and the property. And we would love to see her have it.
Anyone else speaking in favor? I see none. Anyone to speak in opposition?
I'll move we close the public portion of the hearing.
Motion. We have a second?
I'll second.
Motion and second. Roll call vote, please.
Mr. Reininger?
Aye.
Mr. Bartholdt?
Yes.
Mr. Martin?
Yes.
Mr. Price?
Yes.
Mr. Roberto?
Yes. Okay. Start off with questions. Mr. Martin?
I'm also concerned about the precedent here, but you know, I think sometimes we have to be reasonable. We try to be reasonable all the time, and if we were going to grant this, there would have to be some reason why this is different from something else, that another neighbor coming in, for example, and proposing a garage. And I personally can distinguish this by saying there are no walls here. This is basically nothing more than a shelter. Again, we have to be concerned about precedent. So consequently, we can't get ourselves into a situation where somebody comes in and says they want to build a structure that they either want to live in or a structure that they want to store tools in or something like that within the, because that is a huge variance request in terms of the setback requirements. However, I'm persuaded that this isn't terribly different than me going over to one of those Amish places and buying a little gazebo and sticking it in front, my front yard, as would most people, and they probably wouldn't even think about going to the zoning board or the zoning administrator to get permission to do that. So I can distinguish this in that sense, that it's literally just an open area that happens to have a roof on it. So consequently, I can accept the precedent concern, and I will vote to grant the variance.
Okay. Tim?
Just a question for staff. Since the house was built in 2004, how did it get to be a non-conforming use straight off? I mean, did it not have to? Yeah, 2014, excuse me.
I looked in the records to try to track that down myself, and the only mention was is that the house had to be converted to an accessory structure. There was a recognition that you can't have two houses on the lot, but it didn't say anything about them being non-conforming. They could probably interpret that as a grandfathered condition to the property because the house met all setback requirements. The construction of the house was totally legal.
Right.
It just created some accessory buildings in the front yard.
Yeah, if you look, it actually calls the, it's no longer a residence, it's an art studio.
Right.
So that's how they did that. Right. So that's how they were able to do that. They made it, they made the house they built as the primary resident, and everything else became an accessory to it.
So gotcha.
It was a larger footprint of all of them. Right.
That was my only question, actually. Though I have one for you, Penny, if you want to come up. Just a quick question. Why are you sticking the gazebo way out from your house? Is there a reason not sort of in the middle of the yard? Wouldn't that be more enjoyable? Is there a particular view there?
The nine wells for the geothermal and the leach beds come just a little past that red line.
I can see that arrow.
And so I came out on top of those. That whole area in the red line is really non-buildable, I think. That's.
I mean, it's a gazebo. You could still kind of.
I think there's going to be a slab, isn't there?
Yeah, we're going to put a slab.
Oh, okay.
It's the flood thing.
Well, that was my question, too. Just was there a hardship or a situation on the site that made it go so far out towards the road? Yeah, obviously, and it looks like
it's the leach beds and the wells.
You're not going to play loud music out there, are you?
I'm almost 70 years old. I'm a latter-day hippie, but
no other questions.
Don't go away.
Although, well, the thing about the precedent, yeah. I mean, that's, but. I agree, you know, we can't start allowing accessory structures in everybody's yards because next month we'll have 100 people wanting something, but so we just have to keep that in mind.
Ranger.
Yeah. Ms. Brooks, you're to be complimented on the quality of the construction. It's a very delightful piece of work you put in and really...
I've had a ball.
Very, very nice. The... My one concern, a couple of actually, was the distance from the house to the accessory structure. I wasn't real, I know the limitations with your well field and your septic system.
Yeah.
Which makes, it would seem to make it less practical to use since you've got to schlep so far to get to it. The other question was, and I know you've done extensive landscaping in that backyard, could a gazebo be tucked into, I don't know the direction, north, south, east, west, where the allowable area is just before you get to the incline of the hill? I don't have, Mr. Kohler, I don't have a pointer. I can't point to the thing. No. Go back to your, okay, in that area to your left. I see where apparently hoses are there and a small evergreen. Before you even get back to the hills, can you do something in that area? Yeah.
It still would be within there.
Right about here is Mr. Rash's property. Yeah, that's not my property.
Oh, your property stops where?
Right about here.
Okay, well, you've got a flat spot. There was a mulch bed and an evergreen and a,
here?
Yeah.
It's very sloping.
Yeah, I can see, but there's, yeah. It's not a, totally flat.
Come back to 30 minutes.
I think you've enhanced the quality of that.
I'm not looking to build a gazebo. I'm looking to build that structure there. I don't need a gazebo if I can't have it there. It's, you know, one way or the other, you know, or a shelter or whatever. I just want to do some landscaping out there, and I want a little structure in around it. That's all.
Thank you.
Don't go away. I have a question. Okay. Where's the front door of your house? Can you go back to the...
Yes.
Well, that's why I said it's in my backyard.
Where do you go in the front door?
Right there.
All right, so...
That's
my front door. That was kind of where... When I consider a backyard, is opposite of usually my front door. So why are we considering this a front yard?
Well, that was my question. That was my first question, wasn't it, Marty? Backyard. I said, that's my backyard.
And even if you look at the way they talk about a corner lot, that's based upon where you enter the property, isn't it?
Yeah, my address is Day Road.
Has nothing to do with where the entrance is. It's based on street frontage.
Before, and I completely disagree with the zoning law in this respect, because my backyard is opposite of my front door. I mean, that's just common sense.
So I
hear you, and you have, again, I will reiterate the sentiments that you've done a marvelous job with that property.
Thank
there.
You.
It looks gorgeous. You know, I'm not against moving into this position, given the fact that you have a leach bed and you've got geothermal wells that are causing you the hardship that you can't put them anywhere else. Because if you were to put them on the back side of the building, you're cutting into the back of a slope, or you put them in a flat spot. So either way, you can't win. Other than being outside the
slope presented its own set of problems, which I took care of.
So that's my thought process on that. You got something?
Well, you just brought up a good point. If it were an ugly house, we'd probably deny it.
You've done due diligence on trying to treat the community fair, and I appreciate
you. I've lived here all my life. I love this community.
You've come here with clean hands.
Yes, you have. There's nothing on your hands today, so we appreciate you coming forward. I have no other questions for the applicant. Any?
I move that we, given the fact that we can distinguish this structure because there are no walls to it, because of the geothermal issues and because of the septic issues, I move that we grant the variance as requested.
I second.
We have a motion and a second. Roll call vote, please. All right, any discussion? All right, roll call vote, please.
Mr. Reininger?
Nay.
Mr. Bartolt?
Yes.
Mr. Martin?
Yes.
Mr. Price?
Yes.
Mr. Roberto?
Yes. The variance has been granted, ma'am. Thank you. All right, we will move on to case number BZA 2016-12. It's a variance request for a rear yard setback requirement found in Article 7.3.1 of our zoning law. The location of the property is 11987 Walden Drive, and the applicant owner is Tim Cummins of Champion Incorporated. Is staff have a presentation?
Yes, we do.
Thank you.
This property is part of the Kingsbridge subdivision. This subdivision was constructed prior to our current zoning standards, because we find that a lot of these lots and a lot of the setbacks do not conform to our current code in the neighborhood. Some do, some don't. It's not universal. This particular proposal is to take off a covered porch in the rear of the house and replace it with an enclosed room. This is a picture of the porch that would come off. The dimensions of the room would be pretty much exactly the same as the dimensions of the porch that's coming off. The difficulty with this particular one, these are pictures of what the outside would look like. It's a kind of glassed in solarium type room. This is a front view of the house. I didn't get all the way into the backyard for a ground level shot, but it probably shows better on the aerials. This dimension or request is for a reduction from the minimum 35-foot rear setback. The existing house actually encroaches into the rear yard by about 5 feet, or maybe even more. This line that I've superimposed on here would be what the regular rear yard setback would be. The adjacent houses all meet that setback, but this particular one is already encroaching into the rear yard. Let's see. The request, what was the distance? It would encroach into the rear yard by about 15 feet, which would allow 20 feet of rear yard in this particular case. Staff findings are the setback variance requested is substantial since zoning resolution prohibits construction of principal buildings within rear yard setbacks. The granting of the variance would give consideration that's not available to other property owners in the neighborhood. The property in question would likely yield a reasonable return without the variance. Granting of the variance would probably not have a negative impact on the neighboring property, but would create a precedent to allow for principal structures to be expanded into defined setbacks if requested by neighboring properties. Approval of the setback variance would not affect the delivery of governmental services. While there's no topographic challenges with this site, the existing house consumes almost the entire allowable building area of the lot. By taking into consideration the benefit to the applicant, if the variance is granted, is weighed against the potential detriment to the health, safety, and welfare of the neighborhood and broader community. Staff finds that substantial justice would be done by not granting the variance for the rear yard sunroom. Primary justification is that we like to see open space around single-family houses and not have houses encroached very closely to rear yard, that there be some usefulness to having backyards. We do acknowledge that this would be an asset to the house. It would give them more living space. As a matter of fact, compared to the size of the house, I think it's about 20% increase in living space for the house. But there again, the major things are the precedent that it would create and the reduction of open space surrounding this house that the permanent enclosed room would create. Any okay. questions?
Any questions, guys? Thank you. Is the applicant present?
My name is Tim Cummins. I represent Champion Window. Address 12121 Champion Way, Cincinnati, Ohio, 45241. I first met Mr. and Mrs. Snow in our showroom. They came in to look at our sunrooms that we had on display. We made an appointment for them to come out. When I looked at the property, the first thing that hit me, I was worried about the setbacks. But given that I was just using the existing structure, I was not increasing the projection, I was staying within the confines, I really did not foresee any problems. I knew if I went beyond that, there might be an issue. So we agreed for me to design the room basically where the existing awning is and the concrete. If you would go back to the picture where the awning is, could that be done, staff? This awning, as you can see, projects out approximately 10 feet and goes over about 18 to 20 feet. All we were, Mr. and Mrs. Snow, is they have an area that's basically unusable. And what they were hoping, that what I was trying to do, was achieve several things. One, to increase the livable space of the room so they would accommodate their growing family. Two, increase the appealingness of the back of the house to a brand new sunroom that I have pictures basically here.
When we build these rooms, the whole idea is to enhance the value of the property,
to appease the neighbors and to make everybody have a harmonized life. And I did not want to increase the size room. All we're doing is taking a structure, I think that most people would agree with me, that's not so much attractable, and using the same usable space and making a more creative use, increasing the value, increasing the appearance, and so that the neighbors, when they look at it, they have a much nicer view too, and the homeowner itself would be able to use an area that's basically unusable. It's just basically something that's just, it's there. Champion abides by all codes. We buy all the permits. We do everything the way we feel it should be done. Questions?
Let the record show that we've admitted 4 photos in the document. Anyone else speaking in favor?
Well, I'm Rick Snow. I'm the homeowner at 11987. My wife has been a lifelong resident of Colerain Township. We've been married for 30 years. We've lived in Colerain the entire time. Raised 3 kids, put them through the Northwest Local Schools. I am getting ready to retire at the end of next year after 40 years of service with the Sheriff's Office. We're just trying to do some improvements to the house so we can remain in Colerain Township. As you look at this back picture, you can see that there is already an existing concrete patio there. The center part of the patio is pinned to the house. Prior to us moving in, somebody made an addition to both the left and right side of the patio. It's not pinned to the house, and it is now warping, which is causing some issues with the awning. The awning's been there since we've owned the house. It's deteriorating somewhat. It has to come down. We are just looking to put a 3-season sunroom in there, not for really living space, but for functionality. With the weather being bad out and that, we can't go sit on the porch. It's too hot. This would be a climate-controlled room. My wife is retiring at the end of, a year and a half after me, with 31 years of service with the Sheriff's Office. This would be a craft room for her during the year and a room for us to enjoy during summer months and even into maybe November. So it's not really living space. It's more recreational space. And it's a substantial investment. It's a $30,000 room. And the house is paid for, so right now we are in a position to do it before we both retire. Thank you.
Thank you, sir.
Oh, in addition, I spoke to 3 of the neighbors, and they are not attending, but they said it's your house. You should be able to do what you want to do with them. I realize that we have a zoning code. East, west, and one directly on Kemper Road have no problem, which are the 3 that are closest to the property.
Okay. Thank you, sir. Anyone else speaking in favor? Anyone speaking in opposition? I see none.
Move that we close the public portion of the hearing.
Motion. We have a second?
Second.
Motion and second. Roll call vote, please.
Mr. Bartholdt?
Yes.
Mr. Reininger?
Aye.
Mr. Price?
Yes.
Mr. Martin?
Yes.
Mr. Roberto?
Yes. Move to board questions. Mr. Martin.
Well, this is one of those really tough ones. I have to vote with my mind and not my heart. I understand exactly what you're saying. The problem here, as the issue came up in the previous hearing, is precedent. Unfortunately, there's nothing really here that I can grab onto or to say this distinguishes you from any other neighbor that comes in and wants to do the same thing. And you said it very well. I mean, my neighbors, if I came in and said, hey, I want to go into my setback requirement, they'd probably say the same thing as your neighbors. Hey, you're a good neighbor. You should be able to do whatever you want. This is America. The problem is we have a zoning code. And as you said, we have to abide by the zoning code. And you're in law enforcement, so, sometimes the law cuts both ways. And in this situation, the granting of the variance would give a consideration that is not available to other property owners in the neighborhood. That, to me, is the clinching element here. Believe me, from a humanistic standpoint, I would love to say, yeah, sure, no problem. But it just opens the door for everybody else to come in and say, well, you did it for them, so how come I can't do it? And then all of a sudden, we don't have any zoning anymore.
So once you have the zoning in place, you have to abide by it, except in situations of hardship or in extenuating circumstances or something that we can point to and say, this is different than everybody else. Unfortunately, I don't see that here. I'm going to have an open mind and listen to everybody else and so on, but that's where I'm coming at it from now, so I hope you understand.
Mr. Price?
So, question for staff. There's already an existing concrete slab there. If he did not extend and build the additional 10-foot slab he's talking about, and you know, just stayed within the slab he's currently got, would this be an issue then? Closed. Okay, that was actually my only question there.
When was the house built originally? I mean, so obviously before the current zoning resolution. Yeah. I mean, to me, that's somewhat of a hardship in that house was built. Not like it would be today. Like, you couldn't do that today in the same cul-de-sac. So I'm more in favor of maybe voting for it just because they're on a site that is hard to do anything with, but you could argue they should have known that when they bought it. But I think you've been there for 23 years, you said?
23 years.
Just random thoughts that are coming out of my head, but as far as precedent, we've obviously set lots of other precedents throughout the last couple months and years. So I'm not going to use that as an argument, but just those thoughts, no other comments.
Mr. Reininger.
As I understand the presentation, the house is already out of compliance with the current zoning code because it is into the setback requirement. Is that's correct, is it not?
By 5 feet.
Yes.
Yes. So, and we are not increasing the depth of that porch, but the length of the porch. Is that also correct?
No.
We're adding a slab to the, as you face the back of the house, to the left side, correct?
The enclosure is going to be the same size as the existing porch, but they're going to add a slab to the adjacent to that porch.
Yeah. The slab is not subject to setbacks.
Right.
As long as it's not enclosed, right?
Right, I understand. But the house is already into the setback, is it not? The house structure. Right. So we're already out of compliance.
Okay.
This
could increase the amount of time.
That's correct. I appreciate Mr. Barton's comments as always. But I think enhancing the property value is my prime consideration here, and I think it's a worthy idea.
And I would agree with it as well. I mean, you've been here 20-something years. The zoning laws came in well after the fact. This property built, it would never have been built this way had it been according to the zoning laws today. So that in itself is a hardship because he can't pick up his house and he can't physically move it, put it within the zoning requirements to make sure to do the sunroom. So I believe we're seeing a hardship there because he can't move his property, can't move his house to accommodate our zoning laws. And since the structure was already there and grandfathered from that perspective, now we're looking at the patio. It's already there. It's not closed, but I mean, it very well could have been before the zoning laws were put in because it was already there. We would say that patio probably preceded our zoning laws as well. The awning, it's pretty safe to say, I live in a 1950s house and I have an awning that's very similar to that and it was probably there when they built the house. So given that, I would vote in favor of allowing them to enclose this structure as long as they're not exceeding the existing square footage that they have in place. So that's my feedback. Do we have any recommendations for this?
I'd move to approve the variance.
I second.
So we have a motion to approve the variance. No changes or any amendments to it. It's just what's been requested.
As long as it's in compliance with what has been presented.
Okay. So we have a motion and a second. Any discussion? Mr. Martin?
No, this is one of the situations where I'm probably going to be able to vote my conscience, and it's probably going to get approved, so everybody will be happy. Okay. I do try to have an open mind on this, and I really do hear what you're saying. I honestly do. Yeah. And I am befuddled by this one, I must admit.
So. It's frustrating because it's you want to be good to the community,
yeah.
But they're already kind of behind the eight ball to begin with. All right, so we have a motion and a second. Roll call vote, please.
Mr. Bartol.
Yes.
Mr. Reininger.
Aye.
Mr. Price.
Yes.
Mr. Martin.
A reluctant no, but it's going to approve, so you're all set.
Mr. Roberto.
Yes.
Your variance has been approved.
Mr. Martin, I don't take your vote personally.
Yeah, don't write my license plate down on the layout.
I'm actually in charge of foreclosures.
Oh. Thanks, sir. Good luck to you.
Oh, good luck. Have fun with it. And enjoy your retirement.
All right, next case is for BZA 2016-13. This would be for a variance request for an accessory structure to be constructed in the front yard, found in Article 10.2.1, subsection C.
That day.
We've set our standards here, so we'll see how this one falls out. Location is at 40
side of the house we haven't hit.
Mill Road. The applicant owner is Jeffrey Newby, and the staff have a presentation.
Yes, we do. This property contains a single-family home. It is zoned R2, which is a state zoning with a one-acre minimum. It requires a 50-foot minimum setback for a principal structure. Unlike the previous case that you saw with the structure in the front yard, garages are given an exception that they can be located in either the side yard or the rear yard. Side yard for this particular purpose has to be even with the setback of the current residence. It's not side yard based on minimum setbacks, it's actual setback of the house. This particular lot, I've illustrated here where the proposed garage would be located. The allowable area, side and rear yard, is outlined. It's a considerable size, although there are some topographic issues with this site. I say topographic issues, however, I would guess two-thirds of Colerain Township has some sort of topographic issues. That's why areas like Northbrook, Grosbeck, the flat areas developed early, they developed dense. The rest of the township is very, very hilly. So it's not necessarily an unusual condition, and hopefully was something factored into when the zoning ordinance was crafted. This has a fairly new single-family house on the property. This illustration shows where the 50-foot minimum setback would be located, so they theoretically could have placed the house much closer to the road than they chose to do. I imagine they chose this location because it's rather secluded and somewhat sheltered from the road. This is right at the intersection of Old Stone Mill Road and West Kemper Road. The proposed structure would measure 50 feet wide by 30 feet deep. Would contain a two-car garage, but the majority of the space would be workshop and storage. The house, existing house, has a two-car garage attached to it. You can see that there is some slope to the sides of the house. If the garage were attached to the house, it could come further forward on the lot up to what the minimum setback is. This is sort of the location, it's basically where the tree line starts. There's some dead ash trees. That would be the location of the garage. Kemper Road or Old Stone Mill Road is to the right. There's sort of an embankment that goes up and then drops back down towards the roadway, and they've retained some of the natural vegetation on that berm. another picture of the front yard of the house. The location of the garage would be straight off of that turnaround area, the area to the side of the existing garage. And this is the house and looking down the road on Kemper. Majority of this area, houses are built fairly far back from the road. They're secluded in the woods and somewhat sheltered. This particular request is to build the house within, I believe it's 15 feet of the right-of-way. I'm sorry, 25 feet. Initially, they brought in a plan for 15 feet. I strongly discourage going that close to the roadway. A lot of that vegetation that you see in the foreground on that embankment is actually in the right-of-way of the road. The right-of-way is kind of up on top of that embankment. Staff findings are the setback variance requested is substantial since zoning resolution prohibits accessory structures in the front yard of principal buildings. Granting of the variance would grant consideration that is not available to other property owners in the neighborhood. The property in question would likely yield a reasonable return without the variance. Granting of the variance would probably not have a negative impact on the neighboring property, but would create a precedent to allow for accessory buildings in front yards if requested by neighboring properties. Approval of the setback variance would not affect the delivery of governmental services. While there are some topographic challenges to this site, there are similar topographic conditions in the surrounding area. There are no unusual topographic or site configurations issues related to this property which would prevent the reasonable application of the setback regulations. Additional garage space could be accommodated by adding to the primary structure or by a substantial regrading of other portions of the property. By taking into consideration the benefit to the applicant, if the variance is granted, as weighed against potential detriment to the health, safety, and welfare of the neighborhood and broader community, staff finds that substantial justice would be done by not granting the variance for a front yard accessory garage building. And the purpose of not allowing garages and front yards, if you imagine typical subdivisions, you would not particularly want to have a detached garage in the front yard within 25 feet of a street. Because this is rural, I'm not sure that makes this particularly different. It is a sizable building, so it's not quite like the picnic shelter you looked at before that's open. This is a fully enclosed building. Are there any questions regarding this?
Yeah, I have one. You said they could add on to the present garage towards the street, correct?
Correct.
Yeah, add on to the home. And that's because it's attached to the structure, correct?
Yeah, this particular map shows the minimum front yard setback. So if they built onto the house, connected to the house,
yes.
They could go anywhere up to that white line.
So what does the zoning say about if they keep it where it is, but there's a breezeway that attaches the proposed building to the house?
If the roofs are connected, it's considered attached.
Okay. I see that a lot in Oxford.
We're in front of the minimum setback, even at this request. We don't even meet the minimum setback. Is that
right? But it didn't for the accessory building on Day Road either. That building was entirely in the front yard setback, but yeah, this one would be partially within where even a house would not be permitted to be located.
All right. Any other questions for staff? All right. Is the applicant present?
Jeff Newby, 4800 Old Stone Mill. The contours on this site when the house was built. We've been in the house for 5 years. It was built back in 1997, 98. There is like a 50-foot difference from our high point to our low point of our lot. So it's looking for a level area to build on, which where I have it shown is the most conducive to that. With the issue with attaching to the existing garage and coming, I'd have to come forward towards Old Stone Mill, is the embankment there on the west side of my property, which is 10, 12 feet high, which would be above my roof line. So I'd have to address that somehow, probably with a wall or, you know, if I was to do that. So that's the reason I chose where I did. The backyard, I got my septic system back there, and then I have two easements back there for my neighbors to run their outlets to the low spot there in my backyard. So even building in the backyard, I cannot because of those easements. So I do plan on keeping the vegetation along the roadway so the structure would not be seen, just like the house is not seen. That's one of the issues that we like about the house. And so when you're driving on Kemper or Old Stone Mill, the structure is going to be 10 to 14 feet higher than what the roadway is, so the drivers will not be faced with it driving right by. As you can see, the red line, the right-of-way is some distance off of the edge of pavement, and then another 25 feet off of that. I realize that, you know, it's not ideal, but I definitely cannot build the freestanding structure behind the front of the house because of the contours and the septics and the easements back there. So believe it will increase the property value. The structure will be done in the same brick and the same style as the house, so it looks correct and everything. This isn't just going to be a pole barn thrown up or anything. And one of the unique features about my property is that my neighbors, all their backyards face me. There's not a house where their front yard faces my house. So, yeah, I know that's a concern. So, other than that, that's about it.
Okay, thank you. Anyone else to speak in favor? Anyone to speak in opposition? I see none.
We close the public portion of the hearing.
Motion, do we have a second?
Second.
Motion, second. Roll call vote, please.
Mr. Martin.
Yes.
Mr. Price.
Yes.
Mr. Reininger.
Aye.
Mr. Bartolt.
Yes.
Mr. Roberto.
Aye. Okay. Board questions. Mr. Martin. And you, if you guys see, we always like to start with him because he's very thorough in asking questions, and then he leaves very little questions for us to ask. So that's usually why I start with him. So just for a point of interest.
Well, I was promised this was going to be an easy hearing tonight, and it hasn't been. But I really like the suggestion that Mr. Bartolt made, and I'm kind of assuming maybe some of the questions that Mr. Reininger is going to ask about the setback. Is there room for a compromise here? What if you slid that building back so it met the 50-foot setback on that same side and had the covered archway to it? Could you do that?
On the right side of the house there, that's where our bedrooms are. So we wouldn't be able to
I'm not suggesting sliding it all the way back, but you'd have to, you know, and that you'd still need a variance because, again, you're not even with the front of the house. So that's why it's a compromise. It's not okay. Not completely complying. And it might be that you slid it back so that to protect your bedroom view, and maybe it's a 45-foot setback as opposed to a 50-foot. What I'm getting at is there some room for compromise here, or is this an all or nothing?
Oh, no. I mean, I'm willing to compromise. You know, like what was said before, when I first came in, I had it 15 feet off, and I moved it to 25 feet back. Like, you know, I do want to do what's best with the township.
And the board's trying to help you out. I mean, Mr. Bartol's suggestion, I think, was a good one. If we can somehow, you know, tie it, because we are concerned about the precedent setting, and, mm-hmm. and there are some distinguishing characteristics. I'm concerned, you know, the record reflects what staff said. Staff said this lot is not distinguishable topographically, so that kind of takes that out of the, at least that's their opinion. We may or may not agree with that, right. But that's their opinion. Mm-hmm. So I'm looking for some other thing to hang my hat on here.
Yeah, I mean, I wouldn't not mind moving it back as far as I could, but I don't want it to, I would not like it to go beyond the face of the house. If
What's the purpose of this? Is it actually a garage? Or
yeah, it's a garage. I've got a work vehicle, and then I have a classic car I want to bring down also, and then a workshop in there also. You know, so that's the purpose of the building.
But if you could come up with a compromise that maybe involves making the building slightly smaller, moving it back, and accommodating the 50-foot setback, we could perhaps be accommodating and say, okay, it doesn't have to meet the requirement that it be behind the front of the house, because technically mm-hmm. that's what it would
right,
require.
Right.
I mean, there might be room for compromise there. I'm just suggesting that to you, because again, we have to be concerned about the precedent, and that's, you know, you've heard the spiel before, so I'm not going to repeat myself, but is that possible?
I could take a look at that. I'd be, you know, willing to take a look at that and see, you know, right there at the front of the house, the grade really does start to go down
right.
and everything. So to get that 50 foot at the size that I want, and to get the, you know, my idea was also to take that turnaround section of the driveway, you know, just angle it slightly
right.
up to get in, so I don't have my driveway, you know, really close to the front of the house.
Well, as the Rolling Stones say, sometimes you get what you want, and sometimes you get what you need, but right. sometimes this might not be everything. It right. may be a situation yeah, I mean, where there's, you know, something I, yeah, something yeah, in
just,
the middle here.
I'm just explaining why.
Yeah, no, I understand, and again, I'd be much more comfortable if we could say this was a really distinguished property in the sense from topographically, but apparently it's not, and that's part of the okay. issue. So mm-hmm. that's all I have.
Just do that. Tim?
No, I actually agree with Mr. Martin. I think if you just, you know, kind of moved it back a little bit, get it past that, you know, white line there on the map, and is there a reason you need it to be 30 feet wide? That's quite large, isn't it?
I want to put the car in. Put the cars in 20 feet, and then have a workbench to work on the cars also. So that was another 10 feet. I mean, you know, I mean, this is just a very basic concept. I haven't sized anything
yeah.
yet, really. You know, probably it might be 28 feet or 25 feet, you know, 24, but I just came in with the worst case, I think. So.
Okay, that's all I had.
Are you open to the idea of like a breezeway to connect this building?
Yeah, I'd be open to it.
I guess it's hard to show you without going up there, but I was curious if, you know, if you took that rectangle and slid it up here and had a small mm-hmm. roof connection, then we'd get away with part of the problem, right?
Right.
As far as being an accessory building?
And then I would still have to be back behind that 50-foot
well, then line. Then the only issue is the setback.
Is the setback.
But at least then it's not an accessory building, and it's less, or it's more palpable to maybe approve when you just have one small variance to deal with versus one or, you know, two mm-hmm. kind of major ones.
What's okay. the time frame you want to build this?
I don't have any time frame right now because I have to have the variance. So
can I make a suggestion to
yes
you? Can we continue this
sure
so you can come back with a drawing that's going to kind of depict what we're suggesting to you
mm-hmm.
so that'll bring us so it'll make it easier for us to pass this for you.
Okay,
so what I'm going to suggest, or I'm going to make a motion, is that we would continue this
okay.
for the next board meeting. Do we have anything on our docket next month? We're giving ourselves work next month. So we're going to continue. We would like to continue it to next month.
Okay. That'd be great.
Give you the opportunity to, you know, address some of these issues. And we won't do it yet because I want to give everybody an opportunity to still kind of give you some direction and feedback.
Right.
But that's where I'm going to
going to end this with is recommending continuing this to next month.
Okay.
Right, so Mr. Reininger. Okay.
First of all, you've got an attractive home. It's really well designed, and it sits in the property very nicely. I think by taking a look at it architecturally, to use this accessory structure and blend it in with the, as you said, you were planning on the same brick, same roof line, mm-hmm. same shingle. I think it just enhance your property, but nail it in a little closer and get it beyond that 50-foot setback, I think would be where I'd be pushing you.
Okay.
Well, and just to follow up, I mean, that's a good point. Almost create like a courtyard. If you move it closer to the house,
right,
your front yard or where the front door is could become more of a courtyard area, mm-hmm. where you've got like a U-shaped structure around, you know, the front entry.
Okay.
Could be, you know, if it's done well, it could enhance the overall experience.
Mm-hmm.
And one of the other recommendations that I would have is come back with some conceptual drawings of what the building's going to look like.
Okay.
We have an idea of how, you know, not only a placement of what it's going, how aesthetically it's going to look in with the rest of the home.
Right. Okay. We'll do.
It's feasible.
Mm-hmm.
We're trying to help you, I think.
Oh, yeah. 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 Thank you. Thank you very much.
Yeah. And we would like specific dimensions when you come back so we can kind of lock it in. So if you got a guy that's going to build it for you, have him provide you a drawing exactly what you're going to propose so that we can then lock it in.
Okay.
All right. So, so I'm going to make a recommendation. That we continue this to next month's meeting.
I'll second that.
Go ahead.
Timing might be a problem for August, in the sense that the applicant's going to need to go back, revisit his drawings, come up with something, resubmit it, and we're going to have to re-advertise the hearing based on a different scenario than what was originally done, send notices to surrounding property owners.
So we need to talk about
owners. September? So I'm thinking September.
Is that going to create a hardship
that
on
that? Time.
Yeah, that's fine.
All right, so then we will move this to September's. I would make a motion to move this to September's meeting, so we give the applicant an opportunity to get his ducks in order.
I'll second that.
All right, so we have a motion and a second. Any discussion? All right, roll call vote, please.
Mr. Martin?
Yes.
Mr. Price?
Yes.
Mr. Reininger?
Aye.
Mr. Bartolt?
Yes.
Mr. Roberto?
Yes.
Thank you, sir.
Appreciate Thank you.
Being patient with us.
Thank you.
All right.
Have a nice evening.
I believe we have one more. Final of the evening. Patiently waiting over here to the left.
Not least.
BZA 2016-14, request for conditional use permit to install a modular classroom to the rear of an existing school in an R6 residential zone. It's found in our zoning book, Article 4.4. The property located in property located at 2675 Civic Center Drive. The applicant owner is Dwayne Moore of Hamilton County Math and Science Academy. Does the staff have a presentation? Thank you.
Of a educational facility on Civic Center Drive. This is actually the third time that they've come to the Board of Zoning Appeals for a similar request. This is zoned residential, and schools, this is a charter school, is a conditional use within that district. The condition being that they meet all the setback requirements, all the height, parking, etc. But because educational facilities may not be necessarily compatible in all situations with residential development, it's made conditionally approved versus an outright permitted use within that zone classification. And that's why you're seeing it tonight. The property is about 14 and a half acres. The school had previously been approved for three modular units, which kind of show up on that map. And it's kind of tiny for you. This particular proposed unit would be located between the existing building and another previously approved modular unit. The design of these is all very similar. The minimum setback is 50 feet. All of the previous ones met 50 feet, and since this one is even closer to the building, obviously it meets the requirements. The only thing that additional space tends to trigger is the need for parking. We went back through and recalculated parking requirements, and they are getting close to being that 10% under what is allowable, but they do meet the threshold for parking on this site. It's primarily elementary school, so there's probably more busing and staff parking more than anything on this property. This is a photograph of the existing, the permanent building, I guess you'd call it, is on the left. Even though modulars, they are treated as permanent buildings. Those are the ones on the right. And this proposal would be basically in this courtyard area that you're looking at. This is the design of the building, very similar to what was previously proposed. Across the street is a machine tool shop. There's a daycare type center to the north. Surrounding to the west and to the south. To the south is multifamily. To the west is single-family development. Both of those property lines have very dense vegetation. Previous approvals for the modular buildings required that they keep all that vegetation intact as a screen. Typically, if this were a new construction, they would be required to have, similar to what we talked with the Goodyear, a barrier fence plus landscaping. But this more than probably is sufficient for that screening. Staff findings are the use is a conditional use permitted within the with the approval of the Board of Zoning Appeals in the district where this subject lot is located. The use is in accordance with the objectives of the Colerain Township Comprehensive Plan and Zoning Resolution. The conditional use will not substantially and or permanently injure the appropriate use of the neighboring properties if approved, with reasonable restrictions to mitigate the more intensive use of the property, including noise, outdoor lighting, parking. Otherwise, the use will serve the public convenience and welfare. The use will not create excessive requirements at public cost for the facilities and services, and will not be detrimental to the economic welfare of the community. Staff's recommendation is for approval, subject to the condition that the existing dense vegetation along the property lines bordering the adjacent residential development be maintained in its dense condition, and that the location, size, and design of the proposed modular units be as proposed in the drawing submitted by the applicant. Are there any questions regarding this proposal?
The applicant present?
Wife, Mrs. Moore, Dewan Moore. She is the principal superintendent. She's ill. I'm Mr. Moore. Okay. I'm her better half, and I act as the director at the school. So I'm here on her behalf. Okay. And on the school's behalf. We are the Hamilton County Mathematics and Science Academy. We've been in the district going on 10 years now. So this will be our 10th year coming up. We serve a lot of families in the Northwest area, Winton Woods and Mount Healthy area. Our population's about 630 children at this time. We wanted to create more space. We're moving into an area where we have to have more technology available to our children. This will give us an opportunity to expand our computers usage for students. Trying to upgrade our technology because of the testing requirements. But we have been servicing families for 17 years here in this community and abroad. So we hope to get this facility so that we can continue to serve children in a positive light. We have children that have graduated from our academy. Next year will be our first graduating class from college. So we've been around that long, and it'd be a good time to be happy about the academy existing in the community. So we wanted to, at this time, appeal and ask the trustee board to please consider our request for additional space so that we can continue to accommodate the children in the neighborhood.
Thank you.
Thank you.
Anyone speaking in favor of the appeal? Anyone speaking in opposition to the appeal? I see none.
Move we close the public portion of the hearing.
Motion. Do we have a second?
Second.
Motion made. Second made. Roll call vote, please.
Mr. Price?
Yes.
Mr. Bartolt?
Yes.
Mr. Reininger?
Aye.
Mr. Martin?
Aye.
Mr. Roberto?
Yes. Board questions. Mr. Martin?
Well, one, just a comment. We appreciate your presence in the community. I wish you'd put permanent buildings in as opposed to modular, and that's not relevant to your application, but I would hope that that is part of your long-range plan, because I think it's going to enhance your position in the community and the image in the community. So that's a non-relevant comment. The only relevant comment is the parking. 92 spaces, I think, is what we agreed to. That's what you said you have. Technically, you require 96. That is, yes, as staff point out, within the 10% variance. However, if I read the ordinance correctly, they still have to meet that requirement in 13.3.4 capital B, which states that 10% of the spaces required may be reduced as of right, which is what you're doing, but the remaining percentage with a maximum reduction of 50% may be permitted only if the applicant provides off-site parking spaces, shared parking spaces, shadow parking spaces, or an approved alternative. So what I'm suggesting is I'd be willing to approve this, but we have to, I think, and I'll defer to council again here, but I think we have to comply with that requirement, and they have to show either shadow parking spaces, off-site parking spaces, or some alternative plan in order to qualify for that 10% reduction, because they don't meet the requirement.
And would be busing can be considered an alternative?
Oh, we thought that was only if you went above the 10% up to the 50%, that amount would have to be either shared parking, shadow parking, et cetera.
I'm just reading what it says here. It says under B, it says providing fewer parking spaces than the required number of spaces, and then it goes on to say 10% may be reduced as of right. I'm not saying they can't do this, but I'm saying that the record, in order to be consistent here, I think the record should reflect that they did this. If council agrees that they have to do this, and if he doesn't agree, then tell me why.
Again, would not the alternative solution be busing?
Well, educational facilities, I think, factors into their parking requirements that there's probably going to be busing, particularly for our elementary schools. I've always read the as of right as they don't really have to prove anything. This particular site obviously has tremendous amount of area where they could develop additional parking. If we wanted, we could have them shadow that in.
Well, that's all. I'm not suggesting that we don't approve this. I'm suggesting that I think we have to do that. We have to show that there's shadow parking. And I'm using the numbers. I counted the spaces, came up with the exact number that they have, which is 92.
Yeah, that section you were reading, could you read the number?
Yeah, it's on page 136. It's 13.3.4. Capital B, 4.
I think your page numbering might be different. It's B.
My name is Mattson. I'm an architect.
Come, please address at the podium, please.
I address this issue.
If you come to the podium, have you been sworn in, sir?
Yes.
Okay.
Walford Mattson.
Did we close the public portion?
Yes.
Are you opening it, I guess?
Right.
Council, can we reopen the public portion?
50% they have to show the shadow parking.
Yes. Can we reopen the public portion?
Yes, you can.
All right, we will reopen the public portion.
Thank you.
I have the parking plan.
Yes, sir.
92 spaces. And this is an elementary school. Well, I don't think many of the kids are going to be driving to school. So this is an accommodation for the parents coming to pick up their kids.
Yes, sir.
So that, and you may have this. I thought I submitted this.
We do have that, sir.
Oh, okay.
Thank you.
So we have the spaces.
I think.
Thank you.
I think there's another way to read that. I think maybe, is that?
Yeah, as the board directed question to council, I'll respond. 10% of the spaces required in the table may be reduced as a matter of right. We view that, and I view that as council, that there doesn't necessarily need to be a sufficient justification. If the board finds that that 10% reduction as a matter of right, and that they're within that 10% range, then I don't think there is an issue or needs to be the substantial justification. Now, if they were to go beyond that up to 50%, they are going to have to show that additional busing, off-site parking, whatever the means are.
That's fine. I just wanted to get record that we were clear on this, so that's fine. I will accept council's advice on that.
All right.
Tim, Ms. Price?
Nothing.
Do we need to reclose the public portion?
If we do, I move that we do.
All right, so we need
second.
A motion to close the public portion and second to vote on it.
Mr. Price?
Yes.
Mr. Bartholdt?
Yes.
Mr. Reininger?
Right.
Mr. Martin?
Yes.
Mr. Roberto?
Yes.
Now we're back to board discussions. And Mr. Martin, are you finished?
I am.
All right. Mr. Price?
No questions.
Mr. Bartle?
No questions.
Mr. Reininger?
The only question I had was, does this impact emergency protocols for fire drills or for egress or being able to get out of the buildings? Because you're linking so many modulars together, if we cut down the speed with which you can get out of a building in an emergency.
Yes, we have addressed that.
Please come to the podium and address that, sir. Well, we're not opening because what's announced is just a question.
The plans, when submitted to Hamlin County Building Department, will be approved because we have checked all the distances, all the clearances, all the occupancy. I don't think they're going to have any questions.
Thank you. No other questions. Thanks, sir. I don't have any questions on this. We have a motion.
Also move.
I'll second.
We have a motion second to approve the variance as it's been written. Yes, sir?
Different procedure than a conditional use. You're approving a conditional use in this particular case.
Okay, so we are requesting approval for the conditional use, and so we need to have that motioned and second. So do we have a motion to approve this conditional use?
I so move to approve the conditional use for case BZA 2016-14.
All right, we have a motion. Do we have a second?
I'll second that.
All right, Mr. Bartle has seconded. Now we do a roll call vote.
Mr. Price?
Yes.
Mr. Bartle?
Yes.
Mr. Reininger?
Aye.
Mr. Martin?
Yes.
Mr. Roberto?
Yes. Your conditional use has been approved, sir. Thank you. All right, any resolutions for adoption? I see none. Unfinished business? I see none. Approval of the minutes for June 22nd, 2016.
Make a motion to approve per Bo's suggestion that the number of years was changed.
Okay.
I'll second that.
We have a second to that, so roll call vote, please.
Mr. Bartholdt?
Yes.
Mr. Martin?
I'll have to abstain.
Mr. Price?
I have to abstain.
Mr. Reininger?
Aye.
Mr. Roberto?
Yes.
Okay, administrative matters, I see none. Next meeting will be September the 28th, and we are adjourned.
Very good.
Good meeting.